While Ontario hasn't led the way in Canada on vaccine passports, this week the first stage of implementing them went into effect here. What does that mean for your trip to the gym or a restaurant? And how far will it go to putting COVID-19 behind us? Let's ask. In the nation's capital, Raywat Deonandan, epidemiologist and associate professor in the Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Ottawa. And in Hamilton, Ontario, Dr. Martha Fulford, associate professor in the Division of Infectious Diseases at McMaster University. Welcome back to you both.
Thank you.
Before we start, is it okay if I call you both by your first names?
Absolutely.
Fine with me.
Okay, great. So I wanted to start by showing exactly where Ontarians need to show proof of vaccination along with a government-issued form of identification, mostly indoors. If you're thinking about going to concerts, theaters, or cinemas, you will need one. Restaurants or nightclubs, horse racing and car racing tracks, commercial TV and film productions with audiences, water parks, spectator sports, casinos and bingo halls, fitness facilities like the gym, banquet halls, and convention centers. There are a few exemptions for children under 12, use of an indoor bathroom, if you're going into a restaurant to pay and pick up your order to eat out, or if you're going into the grocery store or pharmacies. Raywat, I wanted to start with you. What is your basic view on vaccine passports?
Oh, simple question. Well, I support them, but limitedly and with concern. I'm a brown guy, immigrant to this country, so the idea of being asked for my documents to access services or facilities does not fill me with a great amount of comfort. However, this is going to be a risk-benefit analysis at any given time. So the risk of this being a slow tread towards the tyranny of government must be balanced against the benefit of this tool increasing vaccine uptake and some other good things in getting us out of the pandemic faster. So I think overall, I support it as a tool for accelerating vaccine uptake in particular. So I think it's one of many tools that must be used in a panoply of a diversity of public health tools. In and of itself, it will not save the day. It's one very important tool.
We have seen an uptick on people registering to get their first dose or getting their second dose. So Raywat, why do you think that is, that more people are, or why do you think that that's a way to maybe convince people to get vaccinated?
Well, who are the unvaccinated? They're a diverse, heterogeneous group. They include the hardcore anti-vaxxers, and we have to deal with them in a different way. They include the vaccine hesitant, who just need a good conversation and access to an authoritative voice to walk them through the data. They include people who need and want vaccination but can't get access due to policy constraints. They can't get childcare or time off work. Then there are the apathetic. The apathetic tend to be younger, have a lot of confidence in their innate immune systems, and don't see a reason or an incentive yet to seek vaccination. The vaccine passport is good for targeting that apathetic group. Suddenly, there's an incentive, there's a reason to seek vaccination. So that is where the growth in uptake will be. It won't be across the board for all unvaccinated people, just a particular segment.
And Martha, what is your view on vaccine passports?
I actually agree with a lot of what Raywat just said. One of the questions when we put in a public health measure like this is, what actually is our objective? How are we going to monitor it? I haven't seen that from public health yet. What are we aiming for? How are we going to monitor it? How are we going to evaluate it? Because really what we want, of course, is to ensure that we target the actual networks of transmission, decrease the disease burden in our hospitals. And so there's always a chance with this that it may or may not result in an uptick in, the apathetic's a good term, actually, I hadn't heard it, but it's a great term. But if it doesn't it result in an uptick in the really vulnerable adults who are already our marginalized populations, then we may end up with a lot of inadvertent consequences. We may end up with increased transmission because we're further marginalizing people already marginalized who are now going to congregate in even less safe settings.
How would that work? I just want to follow up on that. How would that work? How would we end up with more cases?
Well, because if we actually further polarize people, so we have all the unvaccinated now sort of congregating together, we may actually end up with increased transmission because they're even further pushed away from a lot of public health measures. And ironically, the vaccinated may end up with a false sense of security because we know that being vaccinated is a personal choice. It decreases my risk of severe disease. But shedding of the virus can happen from either unvaccinated or vaccinated people, albeit less when you're vaccinated. But we may end up with a false sense of security in the vaccinated people thinking they don't have to worry. And so we just, there's a possible inadvertent consequence, and we just have to be aware that this is a possibility, and there have to be measures in place to monitor it. I worry about further polarization. We've already seen this. These are divisive, somewhat coercive policies. It's an unusual public health measure. And if we further polarize people and have even more antagonistic response to it, we may end up with the fence sitters even further away. And so it's important that if we're going to do this, that we have clear parameters on how we're going to measure it, that we have actually an endpoint. What is our endpoint? What are we aiming to do? And how are we going to get out of it? And it's not that it's necessarily a good or bad thing. It's just, I think we have to, if we're doing it, we have to have a really clear stated objective. This is what our endpoint is. This is how we're going to monitor it. And these are all the inadvertent consequences that we're going to take account for. And honestly, if it's not working, then we need to be honest enough to say, guess what? It didn't work. We tried. And let's look at what else we can do, remembering that this is a public health objective. And the public health objective is to minimize the amount of virus circulating in our community and hopefully, ideally, decrease the disease impact and the people in our hospitals. Because the cases in the community are not really what we're worried about. It's the burden on the healthcare system and the severity of illness that we need to worry about.
I have a few follow-ups with what you've just said. You called it an unusual public measure. We are living in unprecedented times. I don't need to tell you that you're at the front lines of this. So a lot of people who have been vaccinated weighed the risk. And I don't know if it was a very easy, because I'm guessing people are listening and watching this. It might not have been an easy decision for them to get vaccinated, but they did so because they were trying to keep their families safe, their children safe, their communities safe. If we don't do something like this because of these unprecedented times, how else can we ensure that we don't go into another lockdown and more businesses suffer?
And so remember, this isn't a question of trying to increase vaccine rates, it's whether this strategy will work. So in Hamilton, for example.
But it's shown an uptick of people getting vaccines.
But will it show an up? Will it result in a decrease in hospitalizations? And that's what I'm saying about how are we going to monitor if it's working? Because if it's all the 20-year-olds who are vaccinated, this is great because it overall will have a decreased transmission. But that's not the population that lands in hospital and stresses the system. And so in Hamilton, for example, the people who aren't vaccinated, it's not hard to find. We look at our postal codes and we see where the highest proportion of vaccinated people are. And it's in what we call our code red postal zones. These are where we have our most marginalized, our most racialized, our most discriminated against groups. It's where we have a lot of homeless, a very large group of people. I don't think the passports are going to help that group at all. It may just further marginalize them. And so that's why I'm just saying it's very nuanced, the conversation.
Raywat, Martha brought up some great points, because if you are if you're unhoused, you might not have ID, and you do need ID along with the vaccine proof to get into these places. We're also seeing people who have been vaccinated get COVID. And I'm guessing for the people who haven't been vaccinated for whatever reason, if they're seeing that people who are vaccinated are still getting COVID, is this a communications issue that we're, what's the gap?
It's a huge communications issue, of course. Pandemics have a way of exacerbating the gaps between people, exacerbating the gaps between rich and poor, uneducated and educated, black, white, et cetera. And policy directives can also do so as well. So Martha is correct. We need to do this carefully and sensitively and deploy a variety of tools to address the possibility of a negative consequence of these policies. We can do these things. And in particular, we need a strong educational component. And as you mentioned, an educational component that includes the limitations and the powers of vaccination, explaining that, yes, vaccinated people can still get the disease and transmit it, but to a much lesser extent. So there's a huge impetus and advantage of getting vaccinated. And I also want to follow up on something Martha just said about what is the ultimate goal here. I agree, we've done an atrocious job of expressing what the goal of this program is. And I would say there are three goals. First is to increase vaccine uptake. The second is to keep the susceptible out of super spreading environments. And the third is to keep businesses open by having them not be the home of super spreading environments. But there are a number of ultimate outcome indicators to look at as well. Hospitalization and healthcare utilization rates are just one. The other is overall population immunity. And we can't take our eye off that goal either, because down the road, when we're talking about whether or not this disease becomes endemic and what level of endemicity we want to accept, getting as much vaccination as possible into the community, even amongst 20-year-olds who are less likely to be hospitalized, is important to keep overall transmission rates as low as possible so that we can live, I hate saying this phrase, live with the disease in a more comfortable way. So there's a lot going on here. We need to have a more strategic and comprehensive set of policy indicators at play. But we've started that process.
Martha, could one argue that vaccine passports are a short-term pain for a long-term gain?
Yes, if they work. I wonder if maybe in Canada we might have done better using the European system of what they call a COVID certificate, if we're going to do this, where it was a slightly more comprehensive strategy, where it was proof of vaccination, a negative test within the last 72 hours, or proof of recovery. And so I think we're all aiming for the same end point, which is to as Raywat said, this will become an endemic virus, and we will learn to live with it as we have with other respiratory viruses. And it's really the tools we use and how to get there. I think there are a lot of lessons to be learned internationally on what has worked and what maybe has ended up polarizing and being a lot more divisive. I would hope that we would have an open mind. You know, in North America, certainly in Ontario and Canada, we've pretty much insisted on just the vaccination route. I think we could learn from Europe in terms of what worked in places like Denmark or Norway, who have already decided or who have already essentially said we are now in the endemic phase and have removed all restrictions. And that's where, again, as Raywat says, you know, knowing our endpoint, our goals is really important, and understanding what's an acceptable level. The UK has got, you know, lessons learned and maybe lessons that we would like to avoid. So I think being a little bit more open-minded. So a conversation I had with somebody yesterday, for example, some of the vaccine hesitancy is against mRNA vaccines, whether correct or wrong. I mean, I personally had no concern to be vaccinated, but maybe why aren't we offering them other options? I mean, maybe we need to meet in the middle instead of sort of becoming polarized on both sides, so that the pro-vaccine are really polarized and the anti-vaccine are really, but maybe what we should be doing is saying, all right, let's get in the Johnson & Johnson. Let's actually just stop trying to have these arguments. And in the end, what we want to do is minimize the amount of virus circulating, give people even more options. And instead of sort of ending up with almost no-win situations in some cases. So I guess I agree that this is one tool of many. We have to be very, very cautious that we track for possible inadvertent consequences, that we actually don't make the situation worse. The idea that the unvaccinated are one, they're not just one homogenous group of bad people. Raywat is spot on when he talks about that. This is a very diverse group of people. We can't just demonize people like that. That's a terrible thing to do. And so meeting people where they are, talking their language, taking the vaccine clinics to where that person is, maybe just giving them options, even if it grates against me as an infectious disease physician, I'm thinking just take the first vaccine you're offered, maybe I should suck it up and say, okay, let's just give this person an option, because the best end result is to get that person vaccinated and not get into a big argument about one or another vaccine. So I guess I'm advocating for a little bit of a more gentle and kinder approach.
You mentioned solutions too, and some of the things that have worked internationally and some things that haven't worked. Raywat, we've been hearing a lot of comparison to that yellow card that we had as children. I have the yellow card from my kids in school, and I have another one from when I travel, which has yellow fever and some other vaccines. Do you think there is an issue with naming this like a vaccine passport rather than maybe an immunity card or something else to that, similar to that?
There might be. A passport suggests you're crossing a border and subject to the inspection of steely-eyed security agents who look you up and down and may deny you access. So there's something authoritarian about it. Maybe an access card. This is a marketing question. You know, a larger question is this unprecedented in terms of our desire to restrict the movements of people based upon their risk status. I've heard that criticism a lot. I don't think it is. If we go back in time, back to 1890, when we had the third great plague pandemic, and we had a vaccine for the plague back then, and the British government decided to enact a vaccine passport for domestic movement and access in India. The unvaccinated were not permitted to access certain areas. So this goes back hundreds of years. And we have other elements in society where we have done this in the interest of public safety and health. The smoking ban is an example of restricting access based upon risk of behavior in this case, not risk of status. So we have a large precedent for this. But talking about it in terms of a passport may not be ideal. An immunity pass is one way to look at it. Let's back up for a second. One of the issues here, is this a carrot or a stick? Some people are saying it's a stick. I don't think it is a stick. It's an additional carrot. If you take this, you now have access to all these services in society. It's an access tool, not a prohibition tool.
Well, right now, I think we are expecting businesses to be the gatekeepers of this process. Raywat, is that fair?
No, I don't think it is. I think businesses need to be supported by government. You don't have the part-time college kid at the door holding back people who might be acting boorish because they feel this is an insult to their civil liberties. It's a lot to ask for someone making minimum wage to put their body work here at risk. So I think it needs to be supported by bylaw officers. There's a lot of work to be done by government.
And Martha, we at the beginning of the pandemic, we did hear about herd immunity. Are vaccine passports enough to achieve the objective of reaching herd immunity?
One of the things we're learning, we've learned very well, for example, is I think last year we weren't sure to what degree a person who had had COVID would actually have sustained antibodies, what was so-called natural immunity. We have to be very careful. We talk about natural immunity. This isn't advocating a free-for-all. But people who have recovered from COVID, in fact, do have immunity, and this is becoming eminently clear. There's some very good studies on this. And certainly the data out of Israel supports this very strongly, that people who'd had COVID and recovered were actually less likely to have breakthrough infections. And so maybe when we talk about immunity, we also need to acknowledge that while our desire is to prevent as much severe disease as possible, clearly, and I would prefer somebody not get sick, but that the person who's had COVID and recovered need to be included in immunity. And this is part of herd immunity. It's a biologic term. It's nothing to do with COVID. And immunity has always been either recovery from infection or proof of vaccination for most infections. And, you know, I appreciate that a year ago we weren't really sure, but we have a lot more data now. We have a lot more information on this. And again, maybe we could learn from Europe in terms of the idea of the COVID certificate or the immunity passport, that proof of recovery actually is considered immunity. So again, it's this, maybe we need to sort of look at what's happening internationally, because in the end, that's what we want. And herd immunity isn't that the virus disappears. Herd immunity is that severe disease is at very low and manageable levels. And this is, again, I think I worry a little bit about the communication, because we haven't been very good about communicating that the personal decision to vaccinate means I'm no longer at risk of severe disease when I get exposed. And it doesn't matter if I'm exposed by a vaccine or not, I'm not a person. Herd immunity means that even though we have circulating virus, it's at a very low level, so it's manageable. And when people get exposed, their immune system essentially protects them.
We've only got 30 seconds. Only got 30 seconds, Raywat. Did you want to add anything else?
Yeah, it's important for us not to overestimate or underestimate the power of vaccines. It's true that they do not prevent against serious disease, but they do prevent against some transmission to a high extent. So if everyone were vaccinated, we wouldn't be in a situation of crisis at the moment. We'd have limited transmission and some percolating disease. And as to Martha's point, natural immunity must be considered in this conversation. Delta comes in like a tropical storm and leaves in its wake havoc, suffering, death, but also immunity. So wait for it.
And that's all the time we have for tonight. Thank you so much for walking us through this, because it's been so confusing, and we really do appreciate your insight. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.